Who remembers what time the sun set yesterday? And so, what time will the sun set today? And tomorrow? And the day after? I could go on. But the point is that we as humans have an innate internal clock that paces our lives from day to day. We, as New Englanders, know that in a few weeks' time we can start planning our leaf-peeping trips as summer turns to fall, as our lush green trees turn to vibrant yellows, oranges, and reds. The seasons pace our years, just as sunrise and sunset pace our days. We all have clocks and calendars based on generations of living on planet Earth. But planet Earth has its own clock. With its 4.5 billion-year history, Earth not only has a strong influence on the rhythms of life, including us as human beings, but Earth has its own clock, which has had huge consequences for life on our planet. 4.5 billion years ago, Earth was a hot spinning pancake of molten rock, and it's been cooling down ever since. And this planet-sized heat engine powers so much of what we experience at Earth's surface, including our day-night cycles and our seasonal cycles, but also catastrophic earthquakes and the building of vast mountain chains. And what fascinates me, and what my research group strives to understand, is how these cycles emerge from the underlying force balance of our planet. Because how this force balance evolves shapes life in the most fundamental ways. My name is Harriet Lau, and I'm a geophysicist. I'm not a Jedi, although I wish I was. And the force balance I'm talking about isn't made of a light and a dark side. It's less George Lucas and more Galileo. And perhaps you might recall Galileo's famous experiment of dropping hopefully inexpensive objects, from the Leaning Tower of Pisa, or Newton's apple falling quaintly from a tree. Understanding the force balance of those falling objects requires understanding every single force acting on them. For instance, air particles might act to slow down the descent of the apple. Those particles collectively resist the apple's motion. But of course, we can't forget the key force here, gravity. The gravitational pull of our massive planet overcomes any resistive force acting on the apple, pulling the apple to the ground, and we can do the same analysis for our entire planet, from the depths of the core right to the surface. Now, the biggest constituent of our planet is the solid rock of the mantle, which is overlain by the crust on which we stand. Together, they comprise of a 2,000-mile layer beneath our feet. And their effect on the force balance is still somewhat of a mystery. What we do know is that the deepest interior of the mantle is 4,000 degrees hotter than the surface. At the base of the mantle, hot rock, believe it or not, expands. And when hot rock expands, it can become buoyant enough to rise from the base towards the surface. In contrast, at the surface, space cools the crust in the mantle, and so the opposite happens. Rock contracts, it becomes dense, and sinks back into the mantle. All this happens because of gravity. And the net result of hot material continuously rising and being cooled from space is that our planet has cooled over time. Now, the rising and sinking of rock means that our mantle flows. Now, this might surprise you because we stand on the ground confident that it'll support our steps. But our solid Earth moves. It dynamically changes shape. It warps. It deforms. But that's not the whole picture. Remember, I said that there's a force balance. So as our solid Earth moves, what's resisting this motion? Turns out rock itself resists motion. The stiffness of rock means that while the mantle flows, it doesn't flow like a fluid. Instead, tiny grains that make up rock shift and reorientate over micrometer scales to give rise to motion. And that tiny motion accumulates across the entire length of the mantle. And so to appreciate just how powerful this force balance is, we must expand our ideas of the scales of space and time across which rock moves. And if we do that, a whole host of cycles emerge that pace our planet's clock. For example, if we stood here 300 million years ago, before the opening of the Atlantic Ocean, North and South America, Europe and Africa were combined as a single supercontinent. England, my home country, and New England were neighbors. Later, that supercontinent was torn apart by the motion of tectonic plates, and today, England and New England are 3,000 miles apart, straddling the Atlantic Ocean. These changes are due to the slow flow of the mantle that sets our continents on their paths over hundreds of millions of years, and continues to do so today. During those hundreds of millions of years, plates scrape past each other, triggering a countless number of rapid earthquakes, fleeting moments in Earth's clock, but devastating to those of us who live along these plate boundaries. Just got your Californian friends. And it turns out supercontinents break apart and reform every half a billion years or so, rearranging how land houses terrestrial life, where these hazardous plate boundaries emerge, and whether our oceans flow as a single global ocean, or as we have it today, in five major oceans that weave between our seven continents. Now let's fast forward. If we stood here just 20,000 years ago, all we'd see is endless ice. We'd be standing atop a several mile thick ice sheet known as the Laurentide Ice Sheet, which spanned half of the entire continent of North America. And here we are today in ice-free New England, surrounded by landscapes that were scoured by the growth of that ice sheet. During that last ice age, 20,000 years ago, globally cold temperatures shifted huge amounts of mass from the ocean into vast landlocked ice sheets that completely changed our planet's force balance. Much of Canada was weighed down by the burden of the Laurentide Ice Sheet. And even though that ice sheet vanished 7,000 years ago, we still see its effect on the force balance. Thousands of years of ice melt triggered crustal and mantle motions that are continuing to cause the bedrock beneath Canada to rebound, to uplift today. And that uplift is due to solid mantle material creeping upwards. And that material has to come from somewhere. Sadly for us, it's the mantle directly beneath our feet here in New England that's flowing away towards Canada. And that vacating mantle causes the crust to subside. And that's bad news because land subsidence amplifies sea level rise. And so even if we didn't have to deal with sea level rise due to global warming, we're locked into fast rates of sea level rise across the northeast of the United States due to an ice sheet that vanished thousands of years ago. That last ice age continues to affect life. In fact, over the past million years, our planet has seesawed in and out of ice ages every 100,000 years. And so, whether it's ice age cycles or supercontinental cycles, today we're sitting at the intersection of many cycles, acting over many scales in space and time, colliding together and unraveling at their own rhythms. Now, I didn't always plan to spend my time thinking about the rhythms of our planet. I spent much of my teenage years immersed in the rhythms of music, especially classical and jazz, preparing ultimately for life as a professional musician. But then I took a road trip from Texas to California, where I have family, and saw spectacular national parks. There's nothing like standing on the rim of the Grand Canyon or driving through Texas for ages that gives you quite the sense of the vastness of our planet. And it was then that I decided to study geology. Turns out, geology was not my calling. I can barely read a map or tell one gray rock from another. And dare I admit, I really like sleeping on a mattress indoors. Thankfully, geophysics was an escape where I can answer the same questions by applying the laws of physics and math, and the mathematical intricacies of a bark fugue mirrored the intricacies of all the rhythms that pace our planet's clock. And so here I am studying rhythms of a different sort, the rhythms of Earth. And so where do we even begin? First, we have to break down the forces that contribute to the force balance, those that drive motion and those that resist it. We need to build theories that can account for these forces over vast scales in space and time. And for those theories to hold up to reality, we must ensure that what we see at the micro scales in rock samples in the laboratory align with what we see at the macro scales across our planet. We must also ensure that we can apply these theories to the slow motions that drive supercontinental cycles over millions of years and to the rapid motions of earthquakes over seconds. In our work, we use satellites to understand how mass varies within the planet. The orbit of these satellites are perturbed by variations in gravity due to the rising and sinking of rock in the mantle. And with that, we can understand the forces that drive motion. In our work, we also track seismic waves within the planet to tell us where the soft and the hard parts of the mantle are, the forces that resist motion. And yet, as powerful as modern technology is in illuminating the depths of our planet, it only provides us with a glimpse of what Earth looks like today. And so we turn to old-school geological features that record the deformation of the crust and extrapolate this motion to the past. We combine all these observations using a unique holistic approach, acknowledging that all scales in space and time matter so that the theories we build are consistent across all cycles or rhythms of planet Earth. Now, these fast and slow rhythms intimately interact with each other and, importantly for us, with life. Remember when I asked you what time the sun set yesterday? Our days are dictated by Earth's rotation. As Earth rotates, different parts of the planet face towards and away from the sun. Earth's rotation, since its formation 4.5 billion years ago, has been slowing down from as fast as 6-hour days to what we know now, our 24-hour day. And this slowing down is due to tidal waves that crash onto our coastlines and create a friction, a resistive force. As a result, our moon has been slowly drifting away by an inch each year. And what's bizarre is, if you backtrack that rate, the moon would have crashed into the Earth 2 billion years ago. Now, there's no evidence of that crash. We've known that the Earth and the moon have been distinct planetary bodies since the earliest days of their formation. So something's amiss. It turns out that the force balance that governs our day-night cycle today changed due to an entirely different cycle. In this room, we now know that our coastlines are continuously evolving as supercontinents are broken apart and recombined over millions of years. So the shape of our oceans and their tidal patterns have changed, which caused variation in Earth's slowing rotation. If we take our changing oceans into account, thankfully, the moon wouldn't have crashed into the Earth so recently in the past. And so there's nothing particularly special about our day being 24 hours. In fact, the trend of lengthening days will continue as tidal friction continues to slow Earth's rotation. But what this teaches us is that a cycle, a rhythm, fundamental to Earth's clock, one that spans billions of years, dictates a rhythm fundamental to our clock, one that spans mere hours. Earth's clock dictates our clock and how we experience time. Time, as experienced by life, by humans, has an intimate connection with what might seem entirely inanimate, solid rock. And although we might only live for several decades in what seems like a blink of an eye to Earth's clock, those decades will be the result of immense geological forces played out over millions of years. But we are not mere bystanders amongst these forces. Life is a key player in the force balance. Let's return to that image of North America 20,000 years ago, surrounded by the Laurentide Ice Sheet. If the ice ages were to proceed as they have done over the past million years, we'd be moving towards another ice age. But our presence, as of all life, has profoundly impacted this planet. It's no surprise to anyone that we're not about to enter an ice age, but quite the opposite. Our remaining ice sheets are disintegrating at alarming rates. In the past 200 years since the Industrial Revolution, we've broken a cycle set over the past million years. Yes. Cycles can be broken. And yet, if we fail to understand the natural rhythms of our planet, if we fail to understand the key players in its force balance, including life, then we have no context for just how far we've pushed Earth off its natural course. Today, we're living at the intersection of timescales of our own influence and those way beyond the timescales of our entire existence. If we, as a species, can learn to appreciate our place in Earth's story, our vulnerability to these reverent forces, and our power to disrupt them, then we can forge our own meaningful and prosperous rhythm, beating centuries, millennia, into the future. Thank you.